It's May 18th, 2020, and welcome to the How to Grow Your Business podcast, brought to you by DBusiness Magazine and Startup Nation. This week, our guests include David Provost, chairman of TCF Bank in Detroit, and Peter Karmanos Jr., chairman of Mad Dog Technology in Birmingham and Pontiac. Here's your host, RJ King.
Welcome, everyone. I'm your host, RJ King, editor of DBusiness Magazine, part of our media. Each week on the How to Grow Your Business podcast, we interview top business leaders and ask them, how do you grow your business? We also have the big three, our favorite stories for the week, covering entrepreneurs and leaders who are forging new markets, innovating products and services, and turning challenges into opportunities. And this week, we have some exciting news from the world of sports. A special thanks to our sponsor, the Van Buren Township Downtown Development Authority, a great place to live, work, and play. Find out more about starting your new business in Van Buren Township at vanburendda.com. Also thanks to Startup Nation Studio for providing and co-producing the How to Grow Your Business podcast. Birmingham-based StartupNation.com provides millions of users with the information, inspiration, and resources they need to start and grow a successful business. Learn more at StartupNation.com. Now we're going to take a look at the big three business stories from our newsroom with Managing Editor Tim Keenan. In our last episode, we told you about Trevco in Madison Heights, which created the Mask Club, where you can buy masks with your favorite superheroes like Superman, Wonder Woman, Aquaman, or the Black Panther. Well, now there's two more mask offerings. Redcliffe Medical in Southfield has launched a transparent face mask called Leaf, which is made of soft, fire-retardant, self-defogging, and UV-blocking silicone. It's a great way to see who exactly you're dealing with. It's also great for the deaf community. Tim, what do you think?
Unfortunately, the masks are the new normal. And one of the problems with masks is that you can't see who you're dealing with. And if you could come up with a way to let people to see who you're talking to or dealing with, even if they're, you know, wearing a mask, I think that's a big plus.
Yeah, and it takes care of that fogging problem that would pop up right away because it covers your mouth. And then there's added features that include filters for your mouth so that you're feeling much better because the germs won't be shared.
I would say any mask improvement or modification or anything that makes it more comfortable is bound to be a winning proposition.
I agree. And then there's maskmarket.com, which offers customizable face masks. The company is based in Commerce Township, and the website features a face mask design tool, which allows people to create personalized or brandable face masks using uploaded images, logos, or artwork. The initiative was started by two brothers, Fred and Mark Hajar, founders of TVStoreOnline.com and UglyChristmasSweater.com. Now, this is great, Tim, because, you know, you could create any image, your favorite logo, a car, a flower, pictures that you're taking in your backyard, whatever.
Here again, some people just don't like the idea of wearing a mask for whatever reason. And anytime you can personalize it or make it more you or a company can brand them for their own purposes, for their own employees, it's bound to increase or help people be more comfortable to actually wear them.
Yeah, and for ladies, you could make it in different colors. You could have them match your outfit. So there's a lot of design elements that can go into this that makes it very fashionable.
I read somewhere that men are particularly don't like to wear masks for some reason. And I think if they can have a Detroit Tigers or a Lions or some other kind of sports team or some other way to personalize it to make it more them, you might get them more interested in actually, you know, complying with these wearing mask rules.
I agree. And in another article in DBusiness Daily News, Mass Mutual Great Lakes, a Southfield-based mutual life insurance company, launched the Collective Financial Group, an all-female financial services firm dedicated to serving the financial needs of women. Here's some stats. About 15% of financial advisors are women, while 70% of women seeking financial advisors say they would prefer working with female advisors. Gina Coleman, Chief Sales Officer for MassMutual Great Lakes, has been named a strategic partner of the group. Marty McLeish has been named Managing Director of the group. I think they're onto something, Tim.
Absolutely. Anytime you can make somebody feel more comfortable, especially when you're dealing with their money, I think that just makes a lot of sense. And as I recall, growing up in grade school, high school, and even in college, the female students were way smarter than most of the guys in the class. So it's probably a good idea.
Yeah, and it's a great recruiting tool in colleges and even high schools, because financial services, you know, kids might gloss over with their eyes and trying to determine, boy, this doesn't sound very exciting to me. But here, you know, if they realize, wow, I can work with other women and have clients as women.
I think it's a great idea.
And those are some of our top stories of the week. You can find the full articles at dbusiness.com, or better yet, visit our website and subscribe to DBusiness Daily News. And now let's turn to the world of sports. On Sunday, the first live sporting event since COVID-19 began occurred at the Darlington Raceway in Darlington, South Carolina. The track Too Tough to Tame is their moniker. It was the return of NASCAR racing after a three-month hiatus. Tim, what happened yesterday? Who was the winning driver?
Well, Kevin Harvick, who drives a Ford Mustang for Stewart Haas Racing, notched his 50th career victory at Darlington.
And how was the race? Was there a lot of crashes? I think there was one like right off the bat, right?
I thought there'd be a lot more, considering the guys had not raced for 10 weeks and they had no practice, they had no qualifying. But there was a crash on the first lap. But after that, the guys settled down and, you know, there maybe was four or five other single car incidents. It wasn't really a crash fest that it quite possibly could have been.
Now, I was working on my next book, so I wasn't watching, but were there fans in the seats?
There were no fans in the seats, which was kind of interesting, because when the race started, and while you were watching it, you noticed there were no fans in the stands, but you didn't really focus on it. It wasn't until the end of the race when Harvick climbed out of his car at the start finish line, and it was complete silence. It's very strange.
Yeah, that would be strange. Now, when's the next NASCAR race?
Oddly enough, the next NASCAR race is Wednesday night at Darlington again.
Wow. And what's that one all about?
It's a 500-kilometer race. Same kind of deal. You know, NASCAR, you know, they've lost 10 weeks of the season. So they're trying to smash as many races as they can into as short amount of time as possible. So they had the race Sunday, they have the race Wednesday night, they have a race Sunday in Charlotte, and then they have another race the following Wednesday at Charlotte. So they're basically trying to do as many races as they can within a one-day drive of Charlotte, which is where most of the race teams are headquartered.
So when's the next NASCAR race at Michigan International Speedway?
Well, it was scheduled for June 7th, but that got postponed and basically was moved to Atlanta because it's closer to the NASCAR teams. So the next scheduled race for MIS now is August 9th.
Okay, and would that weekend potentially have a doubleheader?
It could, depending on how the season works out, but I would expect there will be no fans at that race either.
Okay, well, it's great to see sports again. Major League Baseball is eyeing a return around July 4th, and the NFL is planning a full season starting in September. It's not clear right now how many fans will be there, but I know a lot of guys who weren't too keen on the lockdown said that if it helps flatten the curve so they can watch pro football on Sundays, well, they're all in. What do you think, Tim?
I think this is interesting. The NASCAR kind of experiment this weekend showed that I haven't seen the ratings, but I would imagine the ratings were pretty good because it was the only live sporting event going on. So if the ratings are good and if NASCAR doesn't have any, you know, outbreaks of coronavirus in their garage area, I think it bodes well for the rest of the sports to at least get started with no fans and see, you know, how the pandemic evolves to see how many people can eventually come and watch.
All right. Well, great, Tim. Great checking in with you, and we'll be talking to you in a bit.
All right. Thanks, RJ.
Thank you. Coming up, we'll be talking with David Provost, the chairman of TCF Bank in Detroit. How will David be growing the bank's business? And Peter Karmanos Jr., chairman of Mad Dog Technology in Birmingham and Pontiac. We'll be talking to Peter about how they develop and create software apps and digital platforms. We will be right back after a quick word from our sponsor. You are listening to the How to Grow Your Business podcast.
bordering innovation and technology, Van Buren Township is your business destination. Uniquely positioned between Ann Arbor and Detroit, Van Buren Township is becoming one of Southeast Michigan's most desired locations for autonomous vehicle design and thriving startups. Discover Van Buren Township and become part of this cutting-edge business destination. Visit VanBurenDDA.com.
Welcome back to the How to Grow Your Business podcast. I'm your host, RJ King, editor of DBusiness Magazine and author of Detroit, Engine of America. Thanks for listening. David, thanks for joining us. I wanted to jump right in about the big news today. The bank is accepting a second round of applications for the Paycheck Protection Program, PPP. Why did you decide to launch that?
That is, that's very good news for a lot of small businesses. We decided to launch that right when they opened it up. We were very, very active in the first round. I think we did 20,000 applications with over $2 billion of money out the door. It is a great opportunity for small businesses. I just took one a couple minutes ago for $11,000, an application for $11,000 for a one-person business. So it's a great opportunity, and we're happy to participate and help these small companies out.
And it sounds like you're picking up new customers from this too.
Yeah, about 10% of our applications are new customers. What we did was, as soon as we got through the first wave, we opened up the process to non-customers because there were several banks in town that were struggling with the applications, and some credit unions and some other banks were not even taking them, weren't capable of taking them. We were an SBA-approved lender. We had five people on that staff when this thing started. We added 800 people to this project.
Wow.
Over the last month. So that's almost 10% of our workforce has been dedicated to really helping these small businesses.
And what was the secret there? How did you get everybody on board with this and get the communications out?
Well, we obviously started working from home. The IT team did a remarkable job of getting everybody set up through their home offices. Then it became a training process. And the SBA and the PPP program kept changing the rules all the time. I described it as a basketball game where they change the rules, and a three-point shot now is a negative shot, and a layup is 3 points, and so on and so forth. So you really didn't know how to do it. But we worked through the process. We automated the process, and really were helping these customers through. And I think we were very, very successful. And I got a lot of thank you notes, especially from the nonprofits. We put them at the top of the list. And that was really fun to get that money out.
Well, that's great. And then also last week, TCF Bank announced a new deal with Autobooks. Talk about that.
Yeah, Autobooks is it's great to partner up with Detroit-based companies. Autobooks, we met Steve Roberts about a year ago. This is a solution that we can offer our customers that the mid-market, the small businesses, it's a complete back-end operation. So large companies have big treasury management functions and so forth, but this is for small companies. It's accounts receivable, accounts payable, check writing, and really helps the small businesses with a solution for their bookkeeping.
Right. And I know you were part of our coverage in the May-June issue on the COVID-19 response. How do you foresee our economy playing out as more businesses get back to work?
Well, I think we're more optimistic than most. It is devastating for some businesses. I'm looking at the restaurant businesses, the hotels, the health clubs, businesses where you need a lot of customers coming in the door. But I think we're getting through some of the fear. As we start getting back to work, we'll need more and more services, like we'll need lunches and so forth, and be helping the restaurants. So we're pretty optimistic that we'll get through this, and we're being very safe. I went into gas station to pick up something. I was actually surprised at how many people, you know, were in there wearing masks, and you kind of felt a little better.
Great. And how's work coming along on your headquarters? I know the construction industry got back to work on May 7th.
Yeah, we were very, very anxious to get back. So the foundation's going in. We're still on schedule to be completed the first part of 2022. It's great to build a new headquarter building in Detroit, especially in the banking industry. I don't think there's been a bank building built since probably the early 70s. And it's going to be really nice to see right on Woodward Avenue, two blocks from the DAC.
Yeah, exactly. It'll be right across the street from Comerica Park and just a little south of the Fillmore and the Fox Theaters.
Yeah, yeah.
And David, how will the bank grow its business going forward?
Well, we feel that we're in a perfect opportunity. TCF Bank is one of the 25th largest banks in the country. We're headquartered here in Detroit. We are specializing in small, mid-sized businesses, community banking services. So we have the availability, the opportunity to partner with different businesses in a local environment, but still be large enough to do a lot of great things like the PPP program. It is great to be a part of Detroit and the Renaissance in Detroit, the naming of TCF Center, our neighborhood initiatives program, and all the things that we're doing in Detroit is really, first of all, a lot of fun for us being Detroiters, and the city and the state is really paying us back by opening up accounts and doing business with us.
Yeah, and that's great because you've already got a team in Detroit too.
Yeah, so we already have probably 100 people working down in Detroit. I have an office down there. I get down there almost every day, and just building out our Detroit presence, working with Wayne County and Warren Evans and the city with Mayor Duggan and just a lot of opportunities for us to help the city, but we also, you know, take advantage and get rewarded with reciprocal business.
Okay, great. And for those listeners, how could they access this new round of applications for the PPP?
So we are live on our website. Just go to chemicalbank.com or tcfbank.com, and you can click on COVID assistance, and there's an application there for the PPP process. It's getting to be pretty simple, and if you need any help, they can give us a call, and we can walk them through it.
Okay, well, thank you so much, David. Enjoy your day.
All right, thanks. Great talking to you, RJ.
You too. Thank you. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with Peter Karmanos Jr., chairman of Mad Dog Technology in Birmingham and Pontiac. Now, a word from our sponsor. Artfully blending rural character with suburban amenities, Van Buren Township offers something for everyone. Belleville Lake, the largest inland lake in Wayne County, an extensive parks and recreation system with 6 community parks, a beautiful beach, boat launches, fishing piers, picnic shelters, walking and biking trails, and playgrounds. Van Buren's most recent addition, the Quirk Park Splash Pad, Wayne County's largest, offers fun for the whole family. The DDA commits to the betterment and livelihood of Van Buren Township while celebrating this special place where we live, work, and play. Van Buren Township, where you need to be. Visit vanburendda.com. Welcome back. We're here with Peter Karmanos Jr., chairman of Mad Dog Technology. Pete, thanks for joining us on the How to Grow Your Business podcast. Now, you started Mad Dog Technology in 2015, and you saw a way to tap the cloud to monetize a company's core assets by taking what makes the business great and turning it into new revenue streams. So how do you take a company's business model and put it into the cloud?
The essence of putting stuff in the cloud is that you're eliminating all the on-site computing paraphernalia and programmers and allowing a company to have its basic systems and marketing and everything else running on a shared facility that's probably more secure than its original stuff.
What are some of the business sectors you work in? I think banking, right?
Banking applications, auto companies, selling cars, logistics, keeping track of where everything's at, and smart buildings. understanding how you're using energy and how to save that energy, among other things. Also, I'm working with a company that is producing a Peloton-type generic system so that you'll be able to take your information and move it from machine to machine and manufacture both the aerobic and anaerobic stuff. So your weightlifting in that. We also have a company that has an application that runs in the cloud. Tell you how you're doing with your weights. Tell you how you're doing with your bike riding or treadmills.
Oh, that's cool. Like a personal fitness app.
Yeah. But it's a little more complicated than that because, you know, deadlifting 200 pounds or walking on a treadmill are very different activities.
So how did Mad Dog Technology get through the COVID-19?
I'm not sure we are. You know, all the people working for different companies are perfectly capable of handling things from home, but selling is something that we feel has to be done on a far more personal basis. So we're getting everything ready. We're getting things done. We're finishing projects, but we haven't been selling a lot. And we're going to have to get back to that hopefully sooner rather than later.
Yeah, talk about that. You've been a long proponent of face-to-face meetings, handshakes, looking people in the eye. And I think your one great line is that people don't buy things from you because they like you. They buy things from you because they find value from it.
Right. And it's difficult to explain that value over a computer. All right. So even though they don't buy it because, you know, you're not their best friend, they still need to look you in the eye and believe what you're telling them about the value that you're selling. You know, I'm sitting down here in Florida. I've been down here for 2.5 months, and I'm looking at the Gulf of Mexico, and I'm watching a guy go get bait for, obviously, he's going to take somebody out fishing. He's throwing a net into the water, and I just don't know how he's getting his customers. But it's a nice thing to look at.
Well, I was going to ask you about the COVID-19 response. Florida's done very well, as you know, and Michigan's been a bit behind. How do you think this thing's going to play out as we go forward and businesses can get back to doing those face-to-face meetings?
I think people have to get over being frightened to death, and I think everybody has a responsibility to get more informed and understand what we're facing. I went to a Costco yesterday and down here in Florida, and I stopped at a Target, and I believe that we're probably in for a V-shaped recovery because that Costco and the Target were packed with people, all being socially cautious and all wearing masks, but they were busy. And then I, driving back, it was on Saturday, I had gone somewhere and was coming back, and downtown Naples was packed. The restaurants were packed. The bars were packed. And I thought, geez, this doesn't look like much of a problem right now. We'll see what happens. And the beaches have been crowded. But every social distancing, though, has been pretty good.
Anything new that's coming up from Mad Dog?
Not much right now. We have a company called Resolute to Smart Buildings, an energy company that we think is going to be really, really an important business. And we're trying to figure out just how far we can take it on our own before we need some help, because it's, like I said, I think it's going to become a very important business.
Well, I love the name Resolute. How does it work? You're putting sensors on a lot of equipment, whether it's HVAC equipment or if it's an industrial company, it's, you know, machines that are running. And basically, people have their laptop or their cell phone, and remotely they can, you know, dial up the temperature, lower the temperature, turn on and off the lights.
Yeah, we certainly can do that, but we really hook up anything in a really good Internet of Things application. We have everything that uses energy in a building, all right? And we can first of all, build you a baseline, show you here's how you're spending your money today, all right? And immediately, when getting the building hooked up, we can save between 10 and 15% of your energy just by things that haven't been working right that we'll identify. And then we can also identify another 10 to 15% savings, but you're going to have to make a small investment in a new piece of equipment or do some other repairs. And eventually, we're able to save you between 25 and 30% of your energy use. And that's pretty significant. And you could even say it's a green company when you can save that much. We could say a hospital that's spending $4 million a year in energy, you can save them $1 million. That's a big deal. And it's good for the environment.
Well, that's great news, especially with everything that's going on at hospitals and medical centers right now.
Oh, yeah. Every dollar you save is like $20 in new revenue because of the margins they're operating on. So if we're able to save a hospital system $3-4 million a year, that's several buildings. That's like $100 million of revenue.
Oh, that's incredibly significant.
We have two different ways of doing that. We have what we call our enterprise solution, where we'll go into companies that have a lot of buildings and a lot of square feet. And then we also have our software-only solution that we can just attach to a device that's currently being used, and we can get that done in a few minutes locally and save people still a significant amount of money, but in much smaller buildings. So we have the software only, and the other one called the enterprise. But we have to go in and do all the connecting and that. And it's got a great future. it's been a battle. You know, we've spent a lot of money on developing very sophisticated software that really changes the entire energy business.
I have one last question. How do you plan to grow Mad Dog's business?
We plan to create another fund somewhere north of $250 million that we're going to invest in some very significant cloud-based opportunities, generally around government applications. All COVID has shown is that those applications really are stressed today. They're old, and there's some new stuff you can get done that'll be able to respond a lot better cloud-wise than what's going on today.
Okay, great. Well, Pete, thanks so much. I hope to see you soon in Michigan.
I hope to be back, buddy.
Okay, have a great week. Thank you.
See you later.
Bye-bye. That's a wrap. You have been listening to the How to Grow Your Business podcast, brought to you by DBusiness Magazine and Startup Nation. Visit us at all of our properties. In addition to the magazine, we have DBusiness Daily News, Tech and Mobility News, Detroit 500, and Michigan Makers. And I also wanted to mention Detroit Engine of America, my new book, which chronicles how the city grew to become the automotive capital of the world, was just named a finalist of the Midwest Book Awards. We record every week at the Startup Nation Studios. Thank you to our sponsor, the Van Buren Township Downtown Development Authority. I'm your host, RJ King. Join us every Monday for business growth strategies from Metro Detroit's top business leaders. Until next time, stay safe and never stop dreaming.